Good morning, one and all present in this faculty development program. I welcome you all to the second day of FDP on Lab on Chip. I hope you got benefited on the first day of the workshop. And even the second day, we have got very inspiring speakers who have rich in knowledge in this area. And I'm sure that you will be definitely benefited in these morning speakers. Two speakers are going to talk about the technical topic, and the third session will be non-technical topic. And today the first speaker of the second day is Dr. Murthy. He is formerly a DST Inspire faculty, and he now works in Department of Nanosciences and Technology in Sri Ramakrishna Engineering College, Coimbatore. I welcome you, sir. I request all the participants to mute your mic except the speaker. Now over to Dr. Murthy, sir.
Very good morning, ma'am. And good morning to all the participants from different locations of India. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Very much audible, sir. You can share your PPT, sir.
Okay, ma'am. I will do it, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am. So, during this pandemic, these online tools have brought us all the people from India, not only from India, but also from outside. Usually, I begin with this statement: kindly follow the instructions given by the local health authorities, government of India. Please wear mask and ensure social distancing during this pandemic. Let me open the presentation so that it would be visible. Yeah, can you able to see the slides, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So today it's the organizers, they have chosen a very right and important topics covering multidisciplinary and transdisciplinary domains like lab on your chip, kind of wearable devices and advanced applications, material processing. And this is one of the very need of the hour or need of the day scenario, which could find potential application in multitude of domains. So today I have focused on one interesting topic, so which would really fit in all those domains, like for example in the area of wearables or lab on a chip process or healthcare technologies, in short, if I need to say. Okay, so the topic that I've planned to incorporate in this today's lecture is small is different. So the title is very generous or very generic in such a way that it's difficult to find what I will be trying to impart. But what I'm trying to say through this presentation is that the small is nothing but a domain of nanoscience and technology, or nanotechnology, or the world of nano. And I would like to convey the nanoscience and technology, or nanotechnology, is completely a different perspective in terms of application, in terms of properties, or in terms of structure property relationship. So not only small is different, small nanotechnology is also beautiful. Okay, so the agenda of my today's presentation would be giving the purpose of why one should be able to utilize the small, the nanoscience and technology, And I will be explaining with the real time cases of case studies or real time scenarios how this nanotechnology or nanoprocess being involved in our day to day life. Okay, you will be very astonished and very happy to see that most of the products that are available in the market or the process are being done in an industrial scale where at least nanotechnology or nanomaterials are being utilized. And on the next section of my presentation, I would be sharing about the very few interesting properties of nanomaterials. So most of the properties you will know very well, but I would like to cover it up as we have young faculty members from different domains. And also I will stress it out that nanotechnology is not a core domain like mechanical engineering, electrical or electronics or civil or computer science. Nanotechnology is a transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary domain. I will stress on that. And later on, I would like to carry over with the emerging application that involve nanoscience and technology, where you can be able to find potential research projects or potential domain to carry out your work. So with this, I would like to move on. Maybe if you have anything to communicate, you can please note down the mail ID given here, mpichumani@src.ac.in. You are very welcome to contact me through email. You can reach me through email as well. So with this, I would like to make a transition. So before that, I would like to share one thing, that the images that have been used in my presentation is being obtained from various internet as well as research papers and articles. While the flow of the presentation is being conceived and compiled by me, whereas the images are being obtained available in the Google or even other browsers. So if you have anything in between to discuss or if you have any doubts, don't have any hesitation. You can unmute yourself. Feel free to have an interaction, because I personally think that the interactions, as we have more number of interaction with our peers, then we can able to develop in a much better way. So this is a very first statement that I'd like to share. So with this, I would like to make a transition. So this is a very wonderful and important case study that I have taken it out here, the art of construction. So usually before, if we are planning to make a building or a home, there are several stages are being involved. Okay, so to begin with, we need to make a soil analysis. The quality of the soil, whether the place that we have chosen is the right place to have a building or not. So maybe you can imagine what kind of specialists are being involved in making a soil analysis. It is usually a geologist. Okay, when a geologist given approval, probably we may need to go for a architect where he can make plans on buildings. But usually there is a misconception that whenever we want to make a building or whenever we want to make a home, we usually say the civil engineers are responsible for everything, but actually it is not so. Okay, then once the architect makes a plan, that plan being executed by a civil engineer, and a civil engineer, you need to get an expertise from various domains, like the person who works with civil engineering materials like mason. You would like to get the help from plumber, you would like to get the help from the carpenter, you would like to get the help from the electrician, the interior decorator and the designer. Okay, so imagine to have a building or being a home being constructed, starting from the geologist and architect, a civil engineer, a mason, a plumber, electrician, and maybe you can able to get a guy who looks around the vastu, and finally he will say you have to rebuild everything from the scratch. Okay, he is also a specialist. Okay, so starting from geologist, civil engineer, electrician, plumber, you can able to see a person from a different domains are being involved in constructing a home. Okay, likewise, why I am taking this realistic case study is that, so in order to build a home, experts from different domains are being involved. So like that, for example, if you want a commercial product that is being available in the market, okay, not only a mechanical engineer, okay, it also requires experts from different domains like biotechnology, civil engineering, electrician, electronics. So a lot of domains are being involved to make a product being available in the market. Let me go to the next case study where I have taken a very realistic product that is being available in the market. For example, this product is being used in the art of road safety. This is a very interesting product. So a cop hold a small machine in his hand. So most of you would be able to name what it is. So we call as it is a alcohol detector. So it is a commercially or colloquially called as it's alcohol detector. This is actually a machine that can able to estimate and quantify the alcohol level being consumed by a person, and it gives you a value, a standard value being given in the being read from the monitor, and you can able to say whether yes drunk or not. So depending on the consumption or depending on the percentage of alcohol yes consumed, this will say or indicate the cop whether he has to give a penalty or not. Okay, so actually this is nothing but a breath analyzer. Okay, technically this is called as the breath analyzer. So how does this breath analyzer works? So there is a tube being given here and you need to blow. So there is a sensor inside, and the sensor would need to first understand this is a breath from a human and not air from a cycle pump, or not a compressed air, or not a air from the vehicle exhaust or so. Okay, so this sensor should able to capable this sensor should able to distinguish that this is a breath from a human. Okay, secondly, this sensor should able to get what is the number of alcohol molecules being present in that breath or being present in the air, and later on this sensor should able to make a quantification of the standard calibration, and it should the input signals, the air is converted into electrical signals, that electrical signals are being transformed into a standard readable output. So starting from fabricating a designing a sensor where a chemical engineer would play a major role, am I correct? A chemical engineer would be playing a major role, and in order to design a sensor or in order to fabricate a sensor, a material specialist would be involving along with the chemical engineer and a specialist from biotechnology, since this is associated with the human breath, a biotechnologist would be there. So all the three domains are being involved in fabricating a sensor. And could you please imagine how we can able to integrate this sensor part with the electronics? So where we need to have a domains or specialists from instrumentation and electronics engineering, okay, where they can able to collaborate with the sensing part. And finally, in order to make this entire thing working, we need to do a batch manufacturing, am I correct? So in order to do a batch manufacturing process, obviously a mechanical engineer would be coming into the picture. So starting from the chemical engineer, material specialist or material scientist, biotechnologist, instrumentation engineer, and electronics and communication engineering domains, and mechanical engineer, finally we need to do a marketing. Okay, so imagine we have close to 8 to 9 different domains are being involved in bringing up this very very smaller product in the market. Am I right or not? You have been to lot of skyscrapers and lot of malls in the present day scenario. So have you able to see a small fire detector alarm or a fire sensor being kept in those malls? So there will be a small red light would be blinking on. So there is a sensor which really measures the actual temperature, and if there is any fire, there will be an temperature being elevated, and this sensor measures the elevated temperature, and all in a sudden it gives a control to the room and gives an alarm, and there are few other systems where it opens up the valve and the water will be poured out. So imagine different domains are being involved in fabricating those sensors. Okay, so the main thing that I would like to share in this, that nanotechnology. So for example, a single product being available in the market, not only being involved only one domains, there are a lot of different domains are being involved. And for example, if you want to fabricate a sensing material for those systems, really the nanotechnology plays a major role in fabricating this. So unlike as I have stated earlier, unlike mechanical engineering or electrical or a civil engineering perspective, nanotechnology is a completely a transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary domain. Please make a note of it. This is a very very first take home message that I would like to share to you all, that nanotechnology is completely a transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary domain. The thing is that you can use nanotechnology as a tool to solve problems of your domain. So for example, if you are from a domain that you work on a healthcare applications, or for example you are fabricating a wearable kind of a device, or you are modeling a MEMS based device and so on, for a kind of an application towards a wearable domain. So in this scenario, you can use nanotechnology as a tool, or nanomaterials as being incorporated in your system, or nanoprocesses you can able to utilize and you can able to fabricate. So in that way, you can use nanotechnology as a tool to solve problems in your domain. Okay, so maybe not only this, you can know very well about these examples, how one can able to understand nanoscience and technology. So the actual length scale that what I'm talking is about is of the order of 10 power minus 9 to 10 power minus 12. This is a domain. And this is a completely a contracted domain where we have 10 power 21 or even astrophysical systems are there, or space physics systems are there. But the domain that I'm discussing is all about 10 power minus 9 or even 10 power minus 10. Maybe it is a third scenario where I would like to take the third case study today. It is very, very difficult to feel how the nanotechnology would be, because our highs and the wavelength are limited. For example, I'm just holding a pen. Okay, I'm just holding a pen. So you can able to give a sense or give a feeling. I can able to close my eyes. I can able to touch the pen. I can able to see this is the cap. I can able to say this is the pointer. Okay. I can feel and I can able to say, because this is an object close to of the order of centimeters. This is close to 10 centimeters. Okay, I can able to see with my eye, and I can able to see very clearly because the light which I am using is in the visible spectrum. And imagine if I keep on decreasing this size to micrometer or nanometer, the wavelength associated with my eyes are very difficult. At the same time, the wavelength associated with the light are being very limited, so I cannot able to see those nanosystems. I really need to use a different set of tools to view. However, I can able to take this example. For example, you can just touch your human hair. Don't feel shy to do this experiment in your office. Just touch your hair, just a single strand of hair. Just touch a single strand of hair. The air that you are touching, okay, or the thickness that you are feeling is close to 100 micrometers. And now imagine you just take a single strand of air and you need to cut transversely. It is not like cutting a carrots. You are cutting transversely into 10,000 times. Just to touch a single strand of air, the thickness that you are feeling is close to 100 micrometers. And try to cut transversely this air 10,000 times, you will end up with the nanotechnology. And there is a scale that exists between the bulk system and the nano system, that is a mesoscale, or even a MEMS and NEMS technology being available here. This is a mesoscale that connects the nanotechnology or a very lower size or ultra low dimension systems with the macro scale. This is a macro scale, and this is a micro scale, and this is a nanoscale, and this is a mesoscale that connects the nanotechnology as well as this with the bulk system. So these examples that I have taken, because I would like to give a realistic example how a nanotechnology would be, but still I am unable to make you to feel or realize what is a 10 power minus 9 or even 10 power minus 10. But the thing is that we can able to go up to 100 micrometers or even few micrometers beyond. That's the thing. And as I have stated, I've started with citing that there are a lot of products being available in the market based on nanomaterials or nanotechnology. And for your kind information, I have not taken any of the hi-fi or sophisticated applications being available. I've just taken very, very few commercial applications or very, very few commercial products that we are seeing in our day-to-day life. For example, you have seen these products given in our television with a lot of advertisements. I'm not endorsing those brands. I have just taken these examples to share you that the nanomaterials or nanoprocesses being involved. There is a claim by a soap company that they have utilized an active silver formula. So you know very well that the gold and silver, they are being utilized as ornaments, are being utilized as anklets, are being used in a lot of our tradition. The thing is that this gold and silver, they have an antimicrobial activity property. So this silver nanoparticle or silver in the nano form, it can able to kill the cell wall very clearly. And that's the reason silver, it's having the anti or germ protector. So this company, they have utilized this active silver formula, a kind of a nano form they have used in the soap. Not only that, you can also able to see other forms of application like the activated carbon. Or charcoal technology being available here. For example, this is a Pond's Black Magic that keeps magic that transforms to the faces into white. So they actually utilize the activated carbon. This activated carbon, they have a prime functionality that it can able to trap or it can able to absorb those, for example, the odors or even some impurities being present. And this is a case where Asian Paints, they have utilized again activated carbon technology. This, when you have this coat over the wall, this can also able to trap those odors, bad odors from the air. And here this is a perfume which again utilizes a silver formula. They say it is antibacterial. This prevents the growth of bacteria. And there are other applications in the case of medical field, elastoplast being with the silver. So most of the medical application with our gem, with the gem product, where we'll be having the silver formula. So the reason is that not only these commercial products, you can take any commercial product being available in the market. You can take examples from the automobile, or you can take examples from the electronics, either a nanomaterial or for example this activated carbon, or even this nano silver, they are being with the size ranges of 50 to 100 nanometers, and they find a potential application in this kind of and that's the reason this nano or the small or nanoscience and technology is completely exciting. I can keep going on in naming lot of realistic application involving nanomaterials, but let me proceed with the important driving force that are being available for this 21st century. So there are four important aspects that are really needed for this 21st century, the industrial technology, because there is a industry 4.0 revolution happening where we are connecting our academia with the industry. We are training our workforce. We are training our students and people towards the requirement of the industry. And in most of our academic institutions, they are transforming the students to a industry need students. So which means we are rightly addressing the gap between the industry and the academia. And this kind of FDPs are enabling our faculty, enabling our peers to be in the contemporary technology or to be with the modern technology, modern tools and emerging application. That's rightly stated with the title given for this 5 days FDP. So we are enabling ourselves to get trained with the emerging applications that meets the industry requirements. So there are four important aspects or the facts that are really needed for this industrial technology. The first one is intelligent, multifunctional, robust and low cost. Here also I would like to take a very important one of the case study that I usually cite. So please imagine a Nokia 1100 mobile phone model. Can you just quickly refresh what are the various things that you cannot do with that Nokia 1100, or what are the various things that you can able to do with 1100? That is a very oldest version of the mobile phone. So we can able to send messages, picture messages, we can able to send group messages, we can able to make telephonic conversation. Okay, so we can able to do a lot of things with those model. Okay, now coming into the Android scenario, can you able to list out that what are the things that we cannot do with the Android mobile phones with the present scenario? It's very, very difficult to share. Maybe if you have an Android phone in your hand, can you list out what are the things that you cannot do with your Android phones? It's very, very difficult to share, because we can able to do almost many things with our Android phones. We can take pictures, audio, we can record an audio, video, we can send emails, we can navigate it very well, okay? Imagine if we are in a place where we don't know the actual location, but these maps, they are navigating us very appropriately. Okay, we can do a lot of things. Do you think that these smartphones or the Android phones are intelligent? Really, yes. And they are very, very robust, which means I just keep my thumb impression, or I just keep my head tilted with my tongue out, a face index or a face recognition scenario. And within a span of few milliseconds or a microseconds, our phone gets unlocked. Am I correct? And it is completely multifunctional. The Android phones are completely multifunctional. You can able to do a lot of tasks. And finally, for ₹1,999, you can get one phone, one Android phone and another Android phone free. Am I right or not? So it is a very, very low cost at this moment. So with this thing, we can able to understand very clearly the Android phones. They are intelligent, robust, multifunctional. And for a cost of ₹2,000, we can able to get two Android phones. And these are the real driving force for this 21st century industrial technology. Not only with this kind of an Android phone that I'm presently citing it out, you can able to take another examples of the evolution of a laptop. Okay, so imagine now we have a laptop, the weight of the laptop is close to a few grams, 300 grams or 400 grams, 440 grams, less than half a kg. And you can see the processors. Earlier we had Intel Pentium 2, 3, 4 dual core. Now we have i3, i5, i7 with the 10th generation and so on. So, and we have a Yoga model, slim model, the thickness and the weight, and the touch screen with the availability, with the solid state drives being present. Don't we think that the nanotechnology, at least being incorporated in any of those emerging electronics industry? It is obviously yes. So this is a main reason, the four factors that I've indicated here, this is the main driving force behind this industrial technology. And in going further, not only with the examples that I've taken a few moments ago, for example, a mobile phone or a laptop, this small, the nanoscience and technology, it is being utilized in other various domains. That's the reason I've been calling this nanotechnology as a multidisciplinary field. It's being utilized in agriculture, pollution control. I've utilized various examples with electronic devices and healthcare. Okay, for example, a wearable or a lab on a chip process or a sensor fabrication, energy conversion and corrosion protection or a coating. Okay, or even a catalysis, industrial catalysis process. So this is completely a transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary field. Now imagine now the current world is having a lot of problems. So main thing is that a water scarcity, medical problem, energy and healthcare. If I need to put it in a nutshell, it's energy and healthcare. And we have an issue with the pollution and with the oil crisis. So we have a lot of problems are being available in the market, for example, available in the world. So what would be the ideal solution? For example, we can have a nano system or a nanotechnology, we could be able to give new materials so we can explore new properties. And finally, we are ending up with a nano. So that's the reason I have given as a first take home message that you can use nanoscience and technology as a tool to solve problems in your domain. Okay, this is a very important scenario that I have considered here. You can use nanotechnology as a tool to solve problem in your domain. And from this now on, I will be just using very few slides to just give a important concept about nanoscience and technology. Most of us, we know very well that what will happen when we go into the nano domain. Okay, we know very well. So we have studied, probably we have taught this increase in surface area, or we will say that surface to volume ratio, S by V. These are given in the textbooks. But I would like to take another interesting realistic example to understand this. Okay, I just explained this. So imagine if we have a cube whose side is a square, and you can able to calculate the surface area as 6a square. And what I try to do is I am planning to cut this cube to multiple times, which I make this a to a by 2. And for a single smaller cube, whose surface area would be 3a squared divided by 2. And in total, we have 8 smaller cubes. And now the surface area would be 12a squared. If we have this whole cube as such with the a, the area would be 6a squared. And if you need to cut into smaller pieces, I am increasing the surface area, which is transforming this entire cube into 8 smaller cubes, finally ending up with the 12a square. The entire process is given. I just take a small cube, I cut into 2, then I cut into 8, I cut into 32, then I keep on doing this, I will end up with a nano system. So imagine if these cubes are of the order of 10 nanometers or even 15 nanometers, we will have such a drastic increase in the surface area. So this is the fourth take home message, there will be increase in the surface area. So how to keep this remembered in our mind? We need to go to our kitchen. So most of us, we are involved in cooking scenario with the demanding professional work-life balance. So how we usually cook potatoes? We will take the potatoes, we just clean, and before cooking, we will cut and we'll put into the pressure cooker. What is the reason for making this cutting? The reason is that this is a way. We are just increasing the surface area. So what would happen if we just put this potato as such and cook? What would happen if we cut the potatoes and we cook? So if you put as such, probably it takes a longer time to cook because the surface area is very low in this scenario. Whereas if we cut into multiple pieces and if we cook it in a pressure cooker, imagine this will be cooked very fast because we are increasing the surface area. And this is the one realistic example where we can able to say the increase in surface area would really play a major role. And the second thing about what will happen when you go into the nano domain, this is the fifth take home message, that is a change in the properties. For example, I can take another example with the present scenario. Let me find a object to explain. Yeah, I got it. So this is a pencil that we usually use in our office, starting from our school days we use. Okay, so I just make a cut with a pencil. I just take inside that is a black color thing. Okay, I just connect with these two with the battery, and I just check the conductivity. So what will happen inside? Maybe you can give the answers in the chat box if you are interested. You just take a pencil, you remove this wooden part, there is a black color inside. I just connect it with a battery, I connect with the bulb or connect with the motor. When I switch on the battery, what would happen? You can give your answers if you are interested in the chat box. Yeah, it will glow. Thank you, sir. So the reason is that this is nothing but the pencil center is nothing but a graphite, and you know very well that it is a very, very good conductor. Okay, it's a very, very good conductor. And actually, this is a form of a carbon that we all know. Can you think a carbon that is in the form of a semiconductor? The graphite, that is a very good conductor, which is in the bulk form. But if I take the same carbon-based system or a graphite in a ultra-low dimension system, for example, a nanomaterial, for example, if I need to say it very, very clearly, a carbon nanotube, the carbon nanotube exists in metallic form as well as in a semiconductor form. The same carbon in the bulk form, it is a very good conductor, for example, a graphite. The same carbon in a nano form, it is a semiconductor. So there is a drastic change in the property. We are just shifting a conductor to a semiconductor region. There is a drastic change in the property. For example, electrical conductivity. Here I have taken a lot of colorful bottles filled with colored solutions, so orange, violet, blue, green, so a lot of colored solutions are there. You know what is the major difference in these bottles? It is not only the color. In all the bottles, I have just kept a solution with gold nanoparticles, but I have just varied only the size of the gold nanoparticles. Just imagine with a smaller change in the size, I can able to change the optical property. You can able to get the very different emissive behavior of this gold colloidal solutions. And the major difference in all those bottles, and the only one difference, is that I've just changed the size of the particle. So with the smaller change in the size, there is a change in the properties. Then imagine that we are transforming from the bulk or a mesoscale to the nano domain. There will be a lot of change in the properties, like a physical or a chemical, the one thing, electrical conductivity or optical property that I've indicated. So this is the fourth and the fifth take home message that you can take it out. So there would be a change in the surface area, or there is a drastic change in the surface to volume ratio. And the second thing is that there is a change in the properties. I've just listed out few properties, but if you go on with your specific domain, for example, sir, I'm working with this kind of material, and I would like to check whether this would be useful for the wearable, then probably you need to do a simulation or a modeling. You need to understand that material property. We need to get the electronic band gap spectrum. What would happen in the bulk scale of the same material, and what would go into the nanoscale? We need to get the band gap energy levels. We need to do a computation, and we can use it really very well. That is not an issue. Okay. So this is a fifth take home message that you will have. So with this, I can list out few types of nanostructures that I will be using throughout my presentation. For example, quantum dots or nano dots, nano wires, nanotubes. Imagine this is a one-dimensional structure. These zero-dimensional structures are a quantum dots. They are nothing but a kind of an island structures. Okay, whereas nanotubes or nano wires, they are nothing but elongated structure like this way. And in the case of nanofilms, they are a two-dimensional structure. For example, this is X and this is Y. Okay, and it is elongated in a two-dimensional, and in the case of a three-dimensional, it is being in a 3x, y, and z. And there are a lot of interesting materials, and the properties are being given. Maybe after this talk, I will be sharing this presentation to all of you as a mandate. So maybe you can look into out these structures and the names in your spare time. So let me go and explore a little bit with the nature. And we can able to relate with the current application. So nature usually is our best teacher. And I can able to take an example of a butterfly or a butterfly wings. How butterfly wings, they will be having colors. You can have your answers in the chat box. How butterfly wings, they'll be having colors. Maybe somebody taking the butterfly, dipping in a colored solution and giving it likewise. It's not actually so. Maybe you can answer, you can give your answers. Yes, as Professor Vijay said, it is a photonic crystals. So this is nothing but these kind of butterflies, they, in the surface, they will be having a periodic arrangement of dielectric material, which is nothing but a photonic crystal. I have indicated in this way. And you can able to see these desert beetles. If we able to see the surface of those desert beetles, they're very, very colorful. Actually, this is nothing but a dielectric material. Photonic crystals, they are nothing but a dielectric material. And this is a opal or artificial gems or even natural gems where you can able to see the multiple of colors. Okay, so these are nothing but due to the periodic arrangement of dielectric material inside. And if we need to understand the photonic material, we need to understand the photonic band gap. And if we need to understand the photonic band gap, probably we need to understand the electronic band gap. So what would happen in the case of a semiconductor? Okay, in the case of a semiconductors, the motion of the charge carriers, electron and holes, they are manipulated. Am I correct? In the case of semiconductors, we are manipulating the charge carriers, like electrons and the holes. Am I correct? Likewise, in the case of a photonic crystals, we are manipulating the motion of the photons. That's a simple thing that you can able to differentiate. In the case of a semiconductors, we manipulate the motion of charge carriers like electron and holes. In the case of photonic crystals, we try to manipulate the photons. That's the only thing. So these photonic crystals, how we can able to understand, how we can able to take it out in a realistic scenario. And this is another example that I have taken from our nature. So can you able to see, can you able to say what is this creature? Normally we use this creature to scold our friends. It is a chameleon. Normally we used to scold our friends, I'm right. You have changed like a chameleon. And we have a misconception that the chameleon changes color depending on where it is placed. I take a chameleon, I take it, I place it in this blue color diary, the chameleon changes to blue. I take the chameleon, I place it on a yellow color mat, then the chameleon changes to yellow. So there is a very strong misconception that chameleon changes color depending on where it is being placed. It is not so. Chameleon changes color depending on its mood. Okay, imagine that when chameleon is very angry, it changes its color. And chameleon is very happy, it changes its color. Chameleon sees a prey to eat, it changes its color. Obviously, chameleon, they will also get depressed and stressed. It will change its color. Or if chameleon sees his mate, it will change color. Actually, chameleon in the skins, it is having a kind of a iridophore cells. This is nothing but a nanocrystal that is have a pigment and reflect light. For example, what would happen is that when chameleon is happy, it stretches out its skin. So when it changes the skin, stretching it out, the photonic crystals or the distance between the nanocrystals, they vary and we get the color in a different wavelength. And imagine if it is shrinking with the skin and, for example, the skin get shrink out, the distance between the iridophore cells, you will get decreased and we'll be seeing a different color. So this is nothing but the nanocrystals that have the pigment and reflect light in a different colors. Maybe I've given here, for example, a reflected red energy light and yellow energy light. So chameleon, actually it is having a nanocrystal on its surface. So maybe not only the chameleon, we can able to see a lot of gecko and lizards. So this is, can you able to see my mouse pointer moving? This is one of the common gecko or a lizard that we see in our tropical region, maybe in our homes or in our tree. And you can able to see these are other geckos or lizards being available in different continents in and around the world. And can you able to see the iridophore cells being arranged this way? Can you able to see a very, very periodic arrangement of this iridophores or nanocrystals? Usually we think that these are lizards, chameleons, and we just ignore them as a small creature. But for your kind information, people, researchers, they are being working with them. They are investigating with these small creatures. They try to understand why the reason for these colors, how the chameleon changes colors, and these gecko lizards, they change the colors, and they have identified these iridophore cells, and they have taken a very, very strong investigation using a lot of spectroscopy tools. So it is that nanotechnology is everywhere. This is one of the very, very simplistic examples For example, where if how a photonic crystals or a nano crystals from the nature that we could able to understood. So for example, if you want to fabricate a artificial surface with a different colors, you can have a iridophore cells. You need to stretch it out, you need to elongate it out. Maybe you can have a temperaturely varying systems where it will stretch out or shrink depending on the applied temperature. In that way, you can vary these iridophore cells and you will get multiple colors. And these kind of photonic crystals, as I have said, with the butterflies or with the desert beetles or with the chameleons or with the gecko lizards, they find a very, very lot of interesting applications in this market. So you will be very, very interesting to see what is only a photonic crystal, but can you able to see various applications? For example, in the case of a displays or optical fibers, LEDs and the sensing systems and solar cells and lasers. So this photonic crystal, they have a lot of market and it is slowly starting to emerge. And probably if we need to understand the photonic band gap, like a semiconducting band gap. Okay, in the case of a semiconductor, we will know about a band gap. Likewise, we will be having a photonic band gap and how they can able to origin. I mean, you can able to understand the photonic band gap with Faraday's amperes and Schrodinger like wave equation. Again, the quantum mechanics come into the picture. Maybe a few physicists or a person with a mechanical engineering background, they know very well about this Schrodinger like Maxwell equation. So can you imagine with this potential market being available with a lot of displays, biosources and the systems, you can find a lot of interesting application with this photonic crystal. I've just received a comment that the screen is not visible. Ma'am, is it clear? Can you able to see my presentation and my mouse pointer moving? Can anybody?
Yes, sir, very much so, very much so.
Thank you, ma'am. I will proceed. And this is the next scenario that I will be taking it out. So maybe with this picture, you will know very well that what I am trying to convey. From this on, you will clearly understand what's my idea that I'm going to share. I've just taken a lotus and a lotus leaf. You know very well about this lotus leaf effect, that whatever the water being on the surface, it just keeps roll on. And the reason is that the surface of the lotus leaf that is having a high roughness or this kind of nano protrusion, which makes the water to roll on. Maybe I just take a very smaller example of this. In villages, people use this lotus leaf to have food. Maybe you have known this very well. And what they will do a practice is that they just take a lotus leaf or they cut a lotus leaf with a hand, or they take a dried lotus leaf. They just dip this in the water. So you know very well the water will be keeping on rolling. So when the water keeps rolling on, if there are any dirts or any sand or even any dried dirts, the rolled water would remove those dirts being available in the surface. And for example, what is a thing that we can able to take it out to the present day scenario? Maybe a self-cleaning surfaces or a superheterophobic effect. So this is a two scenario that I have taken it out. For example, this is a completely hydrophilic. So for example, if your water tries to roll on, it will not, since it is having a low contact angle hydrophilic scenario, this will not take away with the dirt. Whereas if we have a super hydrophobic surfaces, when the water rolls on, this is actually happens with the lotus leaf also. When this rolls on, it takes that dirt away. So this is a self-cleaning surfaces. Maybe, for example, you can able to see a water being rolled on and it removes the dirt. And these self-cleaning surfaces, they are really a need of the hour in the case of a very tall skyscrapers being given away with the glass or even with the solar panel being constructed in the outside. For example, if it is a two-story or five-story building, we can use some external elevators to clean. And imagine if we have a stories of 140 to 145 stories of tall building, it is not that easy to clean with the manpower being employed. So really, if we have a super hydrophobic or self-cleaning surfaces being coated with just a water jet or just an air jet being given here, you can just clean those surfaces. And this self-cleaning surfaces, where we learn from our nature. And nowadays, in most of the energy conservative buildings, so instead of glass wall, what they try to do is they will be having a flexible solar cell being deposited on the glass in such a way that it allows partial light inside the room. Also, partial light is being converted into energy. So when you have these kind of flexible solar cells being coated on the walls, obviously they need to be self-cleaned regularly. So if you have this kind of super heterophobic, that would be compatible with the energy generation as well as partial light being shared into our rooms, then it would be very, very interesting. Apart from that, these two interesting scenario that we have taken from the nature, I can able to take other realistic example or other different domains where we will be seeing about the nano-based applications. For example, we are inside a car and we are driving at a very faster speed, and very unfortunately that we hit with a tree or we hit with an accident. So actually what happens is that there is a force that acts opposite to the direction of the acceleration. There is a force that acts opposite to the direction of the acceleration, and this kind of inertia sensor, maybe with the MEMS or NEMS technology, you will know this very well. This is an airbag or inertia sensor. This sensor would be able to get the force that acts opposite to the direction of the acceleration, and this enables the completely airbag. Most of the automobiles, and now with the present mandate, all the automobiles are being equipped with this airbag. So this is protecting the passengers. So this system, for example, the development of a inertia sensor where a nano materials and the nano processes are being involved, and for example starting from the etching or starting from the fabrication process, a nano based process are being involved in fabricating this inertia sensor, and this is very, very, very smaller in size. And nowadays with the very high end automobile systems, we will be having this kind of inertia sensors being coupled with GSM and other IoT systems. For example, if you drive and you met with an accident, very unfortunately, I'm sorry to say this example, so what happens is that this crash sensor enables and inflates the airbag. At the same time, the GSM also activated. So through IoT, it communicate to the nearby police station, nearby hospital, and there are some SOS emergency numbers being stored. It will give information to them. At the same time, the GSM also automatically gives information to the nearby vehicle dealer, so that you make an accident or RMC, you see it, police, ambulance, your close relatives or the numbers that you have stored, even the car dealer, they will come into your place. Because this system is being completely equipped with a GPS. So it exactly shows where the accident would happen or accident had happened. And this kind of smart technology are almost being employed in all the high-end automobile systems. And nanomaterials or nanoprocessors, they are being completely utilized in those scenarios. And this is another example that being fascinated for a younger generation, like a smart electronics, a flexible or a wearable kind of an electronics where you can able to make a multitude out of application, not only with the telephone or with the other parameters. It can also able to measure our health, like other vital parameters, like what is the energy that we have burnt it out, and what is the pulse rate in our body system. And there are few other parameters are being under research that this kind of smart electronic system, they come into the picture. And when you see into the core systems, there are four important components. For example, the batteries, the sensing technologies, the displays, and the storage. They play a very, very, very major role, and nanomaterials, they are being explored or being investigated in such a way to develop these sensors, displays, and storage device. And the entire core system would be having, in the case, if I need to explain with the MEMS perspective, we'll be having a sensing element, we have a transducers that converts the electrical signal into an output signal, and this requires a power supply. And imagine this entire component would be given in a very, very smaller size of even 10 micrometers or even 15 micrometers. This entire system would come into the picture. And we need to understand what is the importance of a sensor. For example, we have a measurement, we have a sensor, we have a processing units, and finally we will be having an output unit. And the importance of a smart sensor is that a partial of the output would be given back as a feedback to the sensor in such a way that the sensing system would automatically reduce the errors or reduce the noises in such a way that the electrical actual output are really reliable. So that is the need of a smart sensor into this market. And if I need to make a classification of a wide range of sensors, for example, starting from biosensors or a chemical sensor or optical sensor, a lot of domains are being involved, starting from the material scientist or the chemical engineer, mechanical engineer, biomedical engineer. They are being incorporated, they have collaborated in developing those sensing systems. And probably you might have heard about this lab on a chip, which is also one of the interesting topic. I think there are other resource persons are being in our board to explain one particular application and lab on a chip process. But here what I am trying to highlight is that just a comparison, what would be the difference between the traditional lab with the versus on-chip analysis. In some cases, it would be called as an on-chip analysis. In the traditional kind of a laboratory scenario where we'll be having a multitude of chemicals with a large quantity of chemicals being involved, we do manual analysis. There might be possibility of errors because we'll be giving the human samples, and in a lot of scenario, the errors would have happened. At the same time, in the case of an on-chip analysis, for example, the quantity of the chemicals that we are using is very, very low compared to the traditional lab. And this low quantity of chemicals, for example, of the order of few microliters, they are being utilized. And it is very instant and very fast. Okay, in the case of manual analysis, it is consuming a lot of time. Whereas in the case of instant analysis, it's a very, very fast process. And this is the entire scenario that I've given here. Okay, the completely the lab being transformed into a smaller chip whose length scale is of the order of few micrometers. And this is a one interesting thing that I would like to share. So most of us we can able to see a wearable in our market, that is a blood glucose sensor or blood monitor, which is really of the size of this presenter is close to this size, and we'll be having a small place where we can insert our the sensor. Okay, and imagine that we need to give a small drop of blood, few microliters, and could you imagine what is the time duration that it takes to give the results? Can anyone share the answers in the chat box, that what is the time that these kind of glucometers give the results? It's less than 3 seconds. I have a one glucometer that gives the results in 7 seconds, but I've seen in the market where they can able to give, there is an answer 5 seconds. Good, thank you, ma'am. There is a system where you can able to give the results in 3 seconds. Okay, so imagine the results are very, very reliable. And depending on what kind of system being developed, for example, the one example that I have taken is two set of electrodes where they'll be having a PVA solution, and when you give a blood sample, it reacts and it generates ions. And when it go to the electrode, you can able to get the difference in the voltage. Maybe I would like to take a realistic example of this sensing system, how it works. Just a moment, I will share a clip on that. Can you able to see the clip? I will just play. Can you able to see the
clip? Lab on a chip, sir.
Yeah, I'm just starting to play. Yeah, so this is a lab on a chip or a wearable. The one glucose strip that I have been explaining. We have an inlet, we have a nanostructure, we have a reaction, and we have a detection chamber. So these are the four important chambers being available. And as I rightly said, we are not going to take a lot of blood. We are just going to give a few microliters of blood. And you know very well that there are a lot of components are being available in our blood. And the main purpose of incorporating this nanostructure is discarding the components from the blood that are not responsible for the glucose. You know very well that there are other components as well. So the components that are responsible for are measuring the blood glucose. For example, this is a color indicative, a green, blue, and yellow. This is just a color indicative in the reaction chamber. They just bind with each other. Okay, and in the case of detection chamber, they go and attach with the respective markers. And finally, depending on the attachment, we will get what is a final associated value of the glucose. Maybe I just take it once again. There is inlet, nanostructure, reaction chamber, and detection chambers. You're just giving a drop of the blood, and as I have rightly discussed, this complete process being done in less than 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3, done. We'll get the output. So that much fast, very highly selectivity, and very highly sensitive. And when you do with multiple times, the results are accurate as well. Okay, it will not go more than 2, 3 to 5 points when you measure it in multiple times. The error bar is very, very low, and it is really reliable. Okay, I'll just go back to my presentation. So that's how the lab on a chip kind of a process being developed, and this is one of the upcoming trend being in the market. For example, nano robots and smart fill, they are being developed. So this is with the presently, this is with the research stage. For example, where it completely avoids the role of the generic medicines or the medicine that we consume throughout for our whole body. For example, if we have a pain in our knee, or if we have a pain in our wrist, so what we do is that we take brufen kind of a system, sorry, some painkillers. So actually we take in the form of a pill or in form of a tablet, so it goes and digests, and all the drug being going into all our body, human body. Whereas this kind of nanorobots or smart fill, what actually does is that they have a drug loaded systems, and they are of the order of micrometers. So when you try to inject this to the body, they go and target to the exact location where you want to deliver the drug. For example, if you want to have a drug being delivered to the knees, or delivered to the back, or delivered to the finger, it goes and it targets to that exact location and it delivers the drug as such. So these kind of nanorobots are being developed so that it can able to go and bind to the it can able to actually target to that particular place, and it can able to deliver the medicine. Maybe if I have time during the last session, I will just try to play a small clip on that. Now I just try to proceed on. So apart from this system, what I have discussed, there are other domains like energy sector. So maybe like I have indicated, 5 thrust areas. Okay, this is the important and interesting thrust areas where researchers are completely required for the upcoming decade. Maybe for 10 to 15 years, these domains, they really require a lot of researchers. Maybe we need to enable ourselves to work in transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary domains. For example, energy sector, or water and oxygen and food and healthcare. And this FDP, it completely addresses with the healthcare and with the energy sector also, where we can able to find systems with consuming low energies. A system which can able to consume very low power and so on. No. And these kind of applications also, they find a very important thing, because nowadays if this FDP is organized in a physical way, maybe I'll be standing near to the podium, you will be listening to us, the organizers might have given a lot of water bottles near to us, and maybe in future, apart from water bottles for drinking, they will be also keeping a bottle filled with oxygen. You know very well that you can able to buy oxygen in the online stores, because now this is one of the crucial parameter, and nanotechnology, it plays a really a major role in developing these domains. And coming to the energy scenario, for example, a development of a photovoltaic system like solar cells, or development of a solid state batteries, because whenever we speak about a batteries, we usually say with the lithium ion. Okay, but for your kind information, now it is also getting depleted like coal. We will not be having lithium anymore, maybe in after 10 to 20 years. So we need to find an alternate material for the batteries. Okay, apart from that, how we can able to harness energy from the hydrogen or fuel cells or non-conventional systems like tidal and wind. For example, we have a kind of these wind structures where need to be having a composite material being coated on the edges, nanocomposites being coated on the edges, because these turbines, they have to withstand extremely crucial climate. Imagine this wind is being installed in a climate of Russia, where the temperature goes to minus 37, this material is unable to withstand minus 37. At the same time, imagine this wind is, this kind of turbines being installed in a tropical climate like India, where the temperature it goes to 40 degree in heavy summer. Okay, so nanocomposites being coated in the edges of these turbines, where it will not be able to crack. When there is, imagine when there is a small crack being generated, it propagate and it just completely break. Okay, and in order to repair this, we have to give a lot of maintenance cost. So nanomaterials or a nanotechnology, not only in this kind of photovoltaic system, it is being evolved, it is being utilized in a lot of energy solution systems. And one interesting material that I've started in this today's session is a carbon. So you know very well the other allotropes of carbon like diamond and so on. But the one thing that I would like to take it out is a graphite, graphene and carbon nanotubes. Okay, graphite, that is nothing but a layered or stacked arrangement of a graphene, and each and every layer of graphene. Okay, this is one layer of graphene, this is another layer of graphene, and these graphenes, they are connected with a weak bond. Okay, and when you try to remove this graphene, and imagine in an experimental scenario where you construct this graphene into a tubular structure like a carbon nanotubes. Okay, this is nothing but a carbon nanotube. Okay, this is a two dimensional graphene, and depending on your synthesis, I've just given it as a rolling scenario, but if you can roll something like this, you will end up with a Buckminster fullerene or buckyballs. Okay, it's like a football, and whenever you try to take this two dimensional graphene and you roll in different way, you will have a multiple carbon nanotubes, like a single wall, multi wall carbon nanotubes, zigzag, armchair and chiral. There are three forms of carbon nanotubes. The way you make a synthesis, depending on that, the properties would actually vary. So these carbon nanotubes, they have a interesting and extraordinary properties. Not only the mechanical property, it also having a very good electrical property that is higher than copper. For example, the current carrying capacity of this single wall or even multi wall is close to 10 power 9 ampere per centimeter square. See the current density. At the same time, the mechanical properties of CNTs is close to 1 terapascal. It is as stiff as diamond, and tensile strength is close to 200 gigapascal. And that's the reason this ultimate nanostructure carbon nanotubes, the tubular form, they are being used not only in the perspective of mechanical engineering domain, it is also being used in the electronics as well. Okay, not only this thing, this carbon nanotube, it finds other domains like development of touch screen, sensing circuits, OLEDs, power storage and displays. And this carbon material along with magnesium and aluminium, they play a major role in developing systems. Okay, maybe if you are interested in working with materials for the future technology, maybe you can consider graphene, carbon nanotubes or carbon along with magnesium and aluminium. And I've said, no, this is one of the example how nanotubes can be utilized to construct a light emitting diode. So you know what is a light emitting diode? A light emitting diode is a scenario where we have a recombination of electrons and the holes. Okay, when these electrons and holes, they recombine, they emit photons. This is a main principle behind a light emitting diode. And this is a scenario where the researchers have taken a carbon nanotube, they have deposited with the two edges with the conducting gold. And they have kept it in a system in such a way that it acts as a transistor. So when they apply the potential, the holes and the electrons, they recombine and they emit photons. So it is being utilized in optoelectronics kind of a perspective, and it emits the wavelength in the region of IR. So for example, if you want to control the wavelength of the photons being emitted, we need to control the tube diameter, because the band gap in this CNT, they are inversely proportional to the tube diameter. So if you want to control the wavelength, we need to control the band gap. If we need to control the band gap, we need to control the tube diameter. And LEDs are being constructed with carbon nanotubes. And this is one of the evolving technology available with the nanotube electronics. Maybe you can note it down, nanotube electronics or nanoelectronics. That is another domain being parallelly evolving in particular with the nano science and technology with the electronics domain. Okay, this is another application that I can able to show on with the defense, with the civil engineering structures for developing ultra high performance concrete or fire retardant structures, and even with the textiles with the hydrophobic scenario, and even with the defense or even with the aerospace where low weight materials are required to be fabricated, because because it directly relate with the fuel being consumed. Okay, in the case of aircraft or aerospace objects, if we keep a lot of, if we keep on adding a lot of weights, probably it consume a lot of fuel. So we need to decrease the fuel, which means that we have to have a very rigid structure, the same mechanical properties, but lightweight. And nanomaterials are nanofiber or carbon nanotube reinforced fiber systems. They are very much helpful. So apart from this, as I have started, there are other products are being available in the market, like cleaning, scratch assistance, anti-icing, fogging, antimicrobial. Okay, there are, these are a lot of products being available in the market. You can take any product that is being available. You can take any technological product. I can able to say at least a nanomaterial or a nanoprocess or a nanotool being involved in fabricating a process. This is a very, very interesting statement that I would like to share. There were few phrases, but now it is being given in a contradictory era. Earlier, there was a phrase that 640 kilobyte of memory, this memory is the RAM, R-A-M, random access memory, should be good for everybody. But imagine everybody, we have a mobile phones, Android phones, starting from 2 GB RAM, 4 GB RAM, 10 GB RAM, 14 GB RAM mobile phones are also available, am I right? Recently being launched. So, and there is a world market for 5 computers. So imagine nowadays, each and every home, we have at least 5 to 6 computers. Imagine a family of 4 members, everyone have an Android phone, and every Android phone can be considered as a computer. And we have a laptop for our office purpose, and we have a desktop for work from home purpose. So at least a family of 4, we will be having a 6 computers. But earlier, there was a prediction that world market for only 5 computers. And there is another phrase that there is no reason why anyone would want a computer in their home. But now, almost for all the processes, we are using computing or computers, starting from the mobile phones or a laptop or with the thing. And this is a very interesting slide that we know it very well. So once upon a time, in 1958, the flip-flop, they were developed. And you know very well the chipset 4004, 8080 microprocessors with the Pentium 2, Xeon, Coral-Dude, i7 being evolved. And you know very well about this Moore's law, about the number of transistors being incorporated. And now with the scenario in the 2020, we are with the scenario of 25 billion transistors they are being incorporated. And the domain that I'm going to introduce is not this transistor system, maybe a different scenario. So this is a, can anyone recognize what is this image? You can give your answers in the chat box. It's a very familiar image that most of us we use while teaching. Can anyone have a guess of what is this kind of an image? You can give your answer. Yes, thank you. This is a very, very first transistors being considered in AT&T Bell Laboratories. This is a germanium crystal. Okay, how beautiful it is. It's a very, very first transistor being created. But now the transistor that I'm going to speak is completely a contradictory domain, that a transistor being created with the quantum dots, that is a single electron transistors. Usually with the, thank you ma'am, first transistor you are given the answer, thank you Kalpana ma'am. Usually the transistors with the name, I mean with the signs, you can able to understand the process with the name. But here this word single electron transistor or SET, okay, don't think that this transistor works only with one electron. Okay, these single electron transistors or a single electron device in sometimes it is called as. So these devices or transistors, it can able to manipulate the each and every electron to be present in the system. And it utilizes a quantum dot. For example, in this kind of a germanium kind of a transistor, or maybe I'd like to navigate to the previous transistors being utilized in this kind of process. We have a, the users have a control to make the electrons to flow inside the system, but not 100% precise control. Whereas in the case of a single electron transistors, where the quantum dot being incorporated, the user will be having a control to make each and every electron to go inside or not. Okay, it is a Coulomb blockade device as well. So which means when the electrons are having an energy greater than this Coulomb energy, it will go inside. And if it is less than, it cannot go, it cannot penetrate. So that's the reason we have these two tunnel junctions being given here. Okay, and the user having a complete control over the electron to go into the device and out of the device. Not only with this quantum dot being utilized for a single electron transistors, as I have stated, you can use a carbon nanotubes to construct the transistors. So this is in the research stage, and when we have this kind of quantum dot or carbon nanotube based systems, so we will end up with a huge number of devices being fabricated in a very, very small places, and all these devices, they work as such. Can you able to see what is the length scale that I am actually speaking about? It's of the order of 10 nanometers. So for example, this is a quantum dot. This is nothing but an island that I've said here, and this length scale is close to 10 nanometer, and we can able to fabricate this with a nano processes or a etching kind of a scenario, or a physical process can also be utilized in fabricating these single electron devices or transistors. And apart from that, we have when we have these devices, for example, transistors and diodes, we can able to construct logic gates. And usually, you know very well what is the purpose of a logic gate. Okay, for example, this is a NOT gate, and this is a truth table I have given. You know very well about these logic gates in the case of a semiconducting system. But here in this case, I am going to say about a logic gates, but they are based on the chemicals. Maybe you have heard about the word called chemical computers. So what I am trying to do is that I am going to take a bottle. Okay, imagine this is a bottle. Okay, this is a bottle filled with some chemical. Okay, so I just add a small external quantity inside. I just add this proton H plus, and imagine the bottle is emitting a fluorescence without this H plus. And when I add this H plus, the fluorescence would be completely zero. Imagine this is a bottle filled with chemical that is giving a fluorescent output. So in the absence of this external H plus, the fluorescence would be there. But now what I try to do is that I just add a small H plus inside the system, my fluorescence output would be zero. And this is a chemical compound. It's a pyrazoline based derivative. Not only this NOT gate, I can also able to construct chemical computers, for example, a AND gate. Imagine if I have two components, this H plus protons and sodium ions. When I have this H plus and Na, then only I will have a fluorescent output. Either one of them, or when we do not have both of them, the fluorescent output completely would be zero. And we can able to construct with these organic compounds, we can able to construct logic circuits. And they find a major application in developing chemical computers, where it is very, very difficult to decode, because it's only the users or the researchers, they only know at the presence of this H plus and N plus only the fluorescent output given. So when the fluorescent output be there, then the value would be one, or the higher, or the threshold is high. When the fluorescent output is zero, then that is a low, or threshold is low. Okay, this threshold high is one, threshold low is zero, and we can able to construct very well this system. And another interesting domain or application is that the evolution of a display, where nanoelectronics it plays a major role. And for your kind information, professors, that industrial automation, it really requires the evolution of the display, because in most of the scenario we have a industrial automation kind of a process where all the tools are being controlled remotely with the computers and with the processors. So the evolution of the display, they play a major role, and nanoelectronics, they contribute a lot. Earlier, we have used this cathode ray tube or CRT mono or CRT color. Then we have this plasma display panel. This is having a very huge shortcoming, that this plasma display panel, they depend on the elevation. For example, you cannot use a plasma display panel television in mountains. Okay, and we have this liquid crystal displays being emerged later on that. And after that, we have a 4K ultra high definition system, and we have this organic light emitting devices, or a flexible kind of a system we have. And now in the market, we have a QD TV, quantum dot based television. You have seen the advertisement. And this OLED TV, it is being broadly said as a curved TV. Okay, where we can use a polymer based display devices, because whenever we have a polymer, we can able to keep this as a flexible scenario. Okay, this enables to keep as a flexible electronics a kind of a system. And nanoelectronics, they play important roles in this place. And this is a comparison of different LEDs that I've shared. Okay, each and every LED is being given with a number. And these LEDs, they are in the very smaller dimension, for example, 2 to 3 millimeters. Maybe if we need to have multiple colors from a LED scenario, we need to keep a dichromatic source or a trichromatic source. For example, if we need to have secondary colors, we need to keep this blue and yellow LED together, and we need to keep this kind of trichromatic source. And even if we need to get a superposition of these wavelengths, we need to have tetrachromatic sources as well. Whereas in the case of LED plus passpar system, we can have instead of these two LEDs, because this occupies a more space. At the same time, they consume a lot of energy. Am I right? Whenever we want to have this final superposition of this blue and yellow, we need to keep these two LEDs, and they consume a lot of space and they consume a lot of power. So instead of this, what we try to do is that we have a blue LED being fabricated, and over which we can coat this yellow passpar. Okay, if we can have the same tetra or a tri source with the UV LED, and we can have this tricolor passpar being coating, or with at least instead of having four, we can have only two with this kind of passpar coating. Maybe you can, if you have your mobile phones, maybe just quickly you can able to see the torchlight available in your mobile phone. What is the color of the torchlight in your mobile phone? Can able to quickly check your mobile phones and say and give the answers in the chat box that what is the color of the LED in your what is the color of the LED given in the small torchlight of your mobile phones? It's similar to white, bluish. It's not actually white. It is, when you look carefully, it is little bit yellow. It is nowadays with the development of technology, it is transparent, but however you can see this smaller yellow kind of a system, which is actually this. Okay, yeah, yellow, that is an answer. Yellow, white, because it is very difficult. At the same time, when you look into the torchlight or even LED based headlamps, what is the color that actually emitting? It is not actually white. You will see LED torchlight or LED headlamps, they are a bluish white or a yellowish white. The reason is that it is very difficult to get 100% white LED. Now still the research is also going on to get the 100% white LEDs. Either the LED would be a bluish LED or a yellowish LED, depending on this kind of a coating. And nano processes are being utilized in order to have this kind of a coating. And coming into the LED kind of a scenario, you know very well this is a conventional light emitting diode and this is a conventional symbol. Whereas I'm just trying to give a scenario how one can be able to utilize a nano wires to construct a light emitting diode. Okay, this image is a conventional light emitting diode, whereas this image that I try to give is a nano wire based LEDs. And light emitting diode is nothing but a p-type and n-type junction. So what I'm trying to do is that I take its substrate, I do a p-type material being drawn, then I have n-type material drawn. So this is a p-type silicon and n-type nanowire. I just make a junction and they emit photons upon making a connection. Okay, I can able to do this very well. Can you able to unlock one interesting features that have been kept in the encircled region? For example, if I need to connect this one LED with the neighboring LED, I will be using a breadboard, I will be using a soldering. Am I correct or not? I am just taking this LED and I will be connecting this LED with a nearby LED. I will take a soldering wire, I take a external wire, or I take a breadboard. And imagine here, can you count how many LED junctions are there? So it is 12 junctions are there. And whether have I used any external connectors to connect these LEDs? No. Okay, so for example, this is one junction, this is another junction. And these LEDs, they are connected automatically, and this is called a crossbar architecture, crossbar nanowire architecture kind of a system, where each and every device, they are connected automatically without the requirement of external wires. Whenever we have an external wire, obviously they will also offer resistance. Am I right or not? So these kind of nano systems, what it enables is that these devices, they connect automatically without the requirement of the external wires. So this is a system of a organic light emitting diodes, where we have a polymer based system being incorporated, and whenever we have this electrons and the holes, they recombine, they emit photons. And this whenever we have this kind of diodes and transistors, okay, we have a nanowire based diodes and we have a nanowire based transistor that you can able to construct, we can able to construct it memory very well. Okay, whenever we have a nanowire based system like transistors and diodes, you can able to construct logic. Whenever we have a logic, obviously we will have a memory. And earlier we had these punch cards and magnetic tapes. We have optical devices like CD, DVD, Blu-ray disc, and now we have this semiconducting devices like pen drives. And ultimately now we are with the streaming and the cloud. And maybe in the future we could able to store a lot of data. And this MEMS based storage is also evolving with the present day scenario, where it consists of three components like actuators, media, and read write chips. So unlike the semiconducting storage devices, for example, if you want to make a real time data tracking in the forest where the temperatures are extremely crucial, the semiconducting devices, they may fail, because if you want to record a climatic data in a desert where the temperature reaches close to 55 in a hot summer, these semiconducting devices may fail. Whereas if I have a kind of a MEMS devices with the energy being backed up inside the system, they are almost being stable. Okay, and these read-write chips, it can able to navigate over the magnetic media, and it can able to read, it can able to store the data, it can able to erase the data very well. And these actuators that are in the four corners, no, four sides, they make this the tips. The tip edge is close to of the order of 10 micron or even 5 microns. Okay. So these actuators, they navigate the tips to move in the magnetic media, and it can able to read and write the contents. And I'm almost with the end of the slides. So can anyone give a guess on what's happening here? There are two specialists with the uniform. They are sitting, and they have a lot of cups in front of them. Can anyone have a guess, give your answers in the chat box? And if you want to unmute and share your answers.
T-testers.
Sorry, sir?
T-testers.
T-testers. Okay, this they are actually employed in industry. It's a coffee testers or a coffee testing appendix there. So the quality of the coffee depends on the roasting scenario. You know this very well. So how the coffee beans are roasted and at what time should the coffee bean should be roasted. So these coffee beans, okay, these are coffee beans are with the different batches. They brewed this coffee and they make our testing. How long this kind of, yeah, thank you, ma'am. How long this kind of people are being involved in doing this coffee testing or checking? Can we employ some kind of new devices to do this kind of a checking? And here it comes the electronic tongue. So imagine we have a test components or test cells, and what actually is that it senses a lot of taste and it goes to the electric responses to the brain, and we have a taste receptor. This is a biological taste system. Whereas this kind of artificial liquid system, for example, this yellow, blue, and these stars, they are being sensed with a different sensor arrays, and they are given with the different sensor responses, and they are being done with a different pattern recognition. For example, when actually a milk turned into sour, or imagine if a system where it is difficult to taste, we cannot able to taste with the human manpower. And we need to employ this kind of sensing system or a electronic tongue to do this pattern recognition. And depending on the sensor, these patterns would be recognized in a different way. Similarly, like an electronic tongue, we will be having a electronic noses. These electronic tongue and electronic noses, they are also a kind of a wearable device. Okay, like how we have a glucometer in our hand, how we have a portable blood pressure sensors or blood pressure wearable in our hand. Maybe in the future, we'll be having these kind of wearables like electronic tongue. Maybe you go to a restaurant, and if you want to check the quality of the food, just keep a small piece of that and you make your own test. It would happen very soon. And this electronic tongue and electronic noses, who knows, it would be directly incorporated with our mobile phones, so that we do not carry all the devices in our pockets. We carry a single device in our mobile phone that can able to track this thing. And likewise, these electronic noses also, they can able to do a thing. So there is an order in, and we have a lot of sensor arrays, and it makes a pattern recognition through artificial neural network. And finally, we could get the orders. So this is a completely electronic system. It consists of different sensors and mixed metal oxide sensors and carbon dioxide sensors. They are fabricated, they are being developed with the nano processes, and finally you can able to get the output. And this electronic gnosis nowadays in the laboratory, they are being employed in understanding the agricultural based product, for example different grains. In the case of alcohol factory, they need to take the wheat, barley, rice or other material, and they need to make a preliminary testing with that. And this kind of electronic gnosis system being developed, it can able to get the information from the grains and the gases being emitted with the grains under a different scenario. So you know very well that what are the various strategies that you can end up in getting the nanomaterial. Either a bottom up processes, you can take the atom by atom or molecule by molecule, you construct, you finally end up with the nano system, or you do a top down kind of a scenario, like we take a chisel and a hammer, how we make a rock into a sculpture. So the same thing is happening with the top down, we'll end up with a nano system. And if there are few dishes I have presented here, if we need to give the technical information about the dishes, for example, we can able to say about the characteristics like salt, spice, chili, tangy, sour, consistency. For example, if you prepare a paneer butter masala, it should be as thick as possible. If I cook paneer butter masala and if I serve, it should not flow like a rasam. And rasam means it should flow like its own consistency. It should not be like a paneer butter masala. So each and every food product, they have its own consistency. Okay, and each and every dishes that we cook, they have their own flavor and aroma, and they have the color and the presentation. So for all the foods that we have, that we cook or we see in the restaurant, these are the very typical characteristics. Like this, the nanomaterials that we cook in our laboratories, they also need to be characterized with the important and specific tools like structure properties, morphology, topology. And these four properties are very, very important, like optical property, as I have stated, electrical properties, magnetic, thermal and composition properties. And how one can able to view these nanomaterials, for example, as I have started, our human eye is completely limited for this domain. And whereas in the case of a micrometer, we can use a microscopes. Whereas if you go into 10 power minus 9 or 10 power minus 10, we really need to get the help of electrons. For example, a scanning electron microscope or a transmission electron microscope. So I'm at the end of the slide. So almost with the thing I've started. So nanotechnology is completely a transdisciplinary. You can use nanotechnology as a tool to solve problem in your domain. And nanotechnology is everywhere, starting from the medicine, wearable, lab on a chip, or even in the automobiles, data storage, catalysis. Also, you take any domain, I can at least relate few nanotechnology based tools or few nanomaterials directly. And I'm in the almost in the last leg of the presentation. Ma'am?
Yes, sir.
May I know how long I can go on, ma'am?
Sir, I think now you can get the, it can invite the questions from the participants, sir.
Okay, ma'am, because I have few clips to share.
Okay, maybe, sir. If you have time, you can share.
Because I think I can wind up by 11, no? So I have very few interesting clips to share with the thing. And may I proceed for at least few minutes, ma'am, if you don't
mind? Sure, sir.
Yeah.
I don't know how the participants are they going to ask any questions? If they ask questions, then
no, probably I will ensure I will wind up with the questions before 11, ma'am. Is that fine?
Okay, yes sir, fine sir, fine sir.
Fine, okay.
Please continue, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So I've just given here a few important creatures here, so I will be just sharing one by one. Maybe the very interesting with the gecko lizards, just a moment, I will share a small clip on that. So this is a very first example that I have taken. I hope you remember. I have said, no, the chameleon the chameleon changes colors, not depend on the place where it is. The chameleon changes color depend on its mood. Okay, now there is one chameleon getting entered. Actually, please watch it very carefully. This chameleon is just in a small bark. It enters with one color. It is still in the same bark. It changes to a new color. Can you able to see it, everyone? Can you able to see the clip moving?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. See, now the chameleon, it stretches the skin. There's a change in the color. So imagine if our students has got this kind of eyes, they can able to see very well during the exams. And now it also changes a different hue in the green color itself. Okay. This is a different hue associated with the green. This is another hue associated with the green. See, now it is transforming four colors in a single shot. These chameleons can also be able to change the color in a different regions of its own body. This is a different color that it has kept. Further, the chameleon changes color. So now you can able to say that the color of the chameleon is almost close to the color of the bark, but still it changes very fast. So when you see this clip very carefully, you can able to see this chameleon has changed close to 18 colors, 18 colors in a single strand. So not only not only this creature, I will also have another clip. So this is a clip that explains one kind of nanocomposite material. So usually we have heard about Banaras silk, different silk sarees, no? Banaras, Kanjipuram, lot of silk sarees. But this is nothing but a spider silk. Actually, the word is it is called a spider silk, but actually it is a spider web only. The researchers, they have been working with this new material. It is a kind of a nanocomposites. So actually, this is how the spider makes a web. Actually, this spider web or this silk is nothing but a nanocomposites, a bio nanocomposite, in fact. And still, researchers, they are very brave enough to catch these spiders, to get the silk from these spiders officially, okay, without killing and without hurting it. Actually, the spiders, they give different kind of spider silk. For example, for making a web, it is having a different nanocomposite combination. And for catching a prey, it is having a different kind of spider silk that is very sticky. Actually, the spiders, they give away these kind of fluids from a very tiny or a micro pores from his body. Okay, this is a fluid kind of a system that is being ejected from a spider's body. And the spider, it takes to wrap insect or to do a web. Actually, this web is stronger than steel, 10 times stronger than steel. And scientists, they have started to fabricate this web synthetically. Okay, not from spiders, because it is very difficult to get this kind of silk from spiders. So they have started doing experiments and getting the thing. Also, this spider web is highly elastic. You might have seen this spider web, they are very, very much elongative kind of property because of the joints that the spider web being given. Okay. This is from the nature that we can learn. And I have another clip to share. Usually, we are very much afraid about the cockroaches. Okay, the cockroaches, they navigate with the antenna. You know very well what is the two antennas that each and every cockroach, after we hit, we usually take this antenna to throw it out. But researchers, what they did is that they try to hack the antenna and they connect the antenna with the electronic backpack. So which means you can make the cockroach to move in a direction that where it want to go. So if you want to make the cockroach to go forward, it can able to go. And if you want to make the cockroach to go left side, you can able to control with the remote. And the main application is that when there is an earthquake, it's difficult for the people to go. But these cockroaches backpack with a microphone, you can able to navigate. And you can able to get a microphone being embedded, you can able to track them. Okay. With the electronic devices, maybe it would be very difficult because of the battery and so on. But with these kind of cockroaches, or even with the moths, or even with the butterflies, they are called as biobots. You can able to reach the actual places. So they can, without hurting it, they can able to navigate very well. So maybe the next time that you see a cockroach, please don't try to kill it, because actually it saves the life. So I think I'm almost done. Maybe with the time thing, I just would stop here. If there are any questions, I'm very happy to interact.
Participants, if you've got any questions, you can post it now.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. This is Srini here from SRMIST Mechatronics Department.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. It is really a very good session, especially on the basics of nanomaterials. As you rightly said, I'm a mechatronics engineer and electronics. Definitely, it is a breakthrough in our knowledge. So much of applications you have shown to me. Thank you so much. And one stuff which I wanted to ask question is that when we talk about the fabrication of materials, so instrument, what is the preferred fabrication? Do you think that printing technology will be the major fabrication method in nanotechnologies to produce some products?
Actually, for the industrial perspective or for the bulk fabrication technology, now the industry, they are moving for additive manufacturing. If I need to say with the word called additive manufacturing, I am labeling it out as a 3D printing kind of an architecture. Or if your application is towards the electronics in kind of an industry where printing technology would be there, like a 3D printers or additive manufacturing kind of technology. For the electronics also, we have a printing technology, because this kind of printing technology enables a very straightforward method, and it is a very quick and cost expensive. And I mean, it is not a cost expensive, it's a straightforward and very cheap. So you can avail this kind of printing technologies to fabricate systems.
Okay, sir. Any facilities in India where they can have that printing technologies in India to fabricate it? Because
actually, one main constraint with this kind of printing technology is that because, for example, I'm going to do a printed electronics board. For example, I'm going to fabricate a OLED, or I'm going to fabricate a plastic electronics or a flexible electronics. Okay, sir. So if we are doing that, I need to do a printing with the organic polymer kind of a system. And if I want to do it in a place where I cannot be able to control the atmosphere, then they will oxidize this very fast. So one of the requirement for having this kind of printed circuit board laboratories is that the clean room. that's a main main drawback in India, where we afraid to do a expenditure on this clean room because the maintenance of class clean rooms are very, very high. And whenever we have class clean room, we cannot only have this kind of electronic printing circuitry systems. We can have also additional instruments. Maybe I request you to have a nano electronics fabrication laboratory at IIT Bombay.
Okay, sir.
Thank they might so be much. Having this kind of a facility, and because they have established this facility very recently. Also, you have heard about the INUP program, sir?
No, sir. No.
Indian Nano Electronics User Program. You can also avail that option. You can collaborate with premier IITs where they will be having this thing.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And let me go into the chat box. There are very few questions. Maybe I need to stop sharing the content. I'll go into the chat box to see a few questions. There were few questions. What kind of moods you can predict from this video, sir? Actually, for that chameleon thing, they have given few things. Actually, I assume that this chameleon, it was in a mixed state because there was a cameraman hiding nearby. So this chameleon doesn't know whether the man with the camera is going to kill or not. At the same time, in order to make this kind of multiple colors, the cameraman itself might have kept some prey to eat. Okay, it is something like to make the chameleon to think in a different way in a single system. So he might have kept some food somewhere, he might have kept his mate in somewhere, or he might have kept a different chameleon mind stressing colors in a different place. So that's the reason this chameleon might have changed different moods in a single shot. I think so. There is another question for surface morphology calculation in case of thin films. FESEM or TEM, which is better? Surface morphology calculation. For surface morphology calculation of thin films, I recommend a cross-sectional FESEM, because this cross-sectional SEM would give the information on the surface morphology. At the same time, it could give the information on the thickness as well. TEM, it would not be proper, because TEM, it would give the structural property better. So for surface morphology, I recommend the FESEM. If possible, there are a lot of FEMs, the SEM models, they come with the rotatory in the Z direction, where you can take the cross-sectional SEM. I go to the next session, next question. I will share the PPT, sure. Can we use chips to differentiate two kind of worm? So which means for biological application, for example, each and every worm or a bio systems, they integrate or target with a different system, I suppose. So maybe with a single chip, by means of changing the output potential, maybe you can able to make kind of differentiation, I think. Actually, Dr. T. Sindhil Kumar, sir, I'm unable to get your complete question properly. So hence, I am difficult to answer this question. Which means you want to differentiate a biological kind of a worm using an electronic circuit or what, sir? Dr. T. Sindhil Kumar, sir, I am unable to get your complete question. Maybe you can give your answers in the chat box, sir, or question in the chat box. Ma'am, other questions? Is there any other questions, ma'am?
Can we use chips to differentiate two worms?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I'm unable to get what is trying to get the question, ma'am. I'm unable to get it question properly, which means he's asking about electronic kind of chips to work with the biological system. I think so. If my guess is correct, maybe we can use a single chip, but with a different potential or with the output of the chip, we can able to do it, ma'am.
Okay, sir. So you gave us a lot of information, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
And it opened the doors of research for many of them, I think. For me,
thank you, thank you.
I hope the same for others too. Over to Bhagyalakshmi.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir, it's my chance to deliver this vote of thanks to Dr. Murthy Pichamani, sir, Department of Nanotechnology, Sri Ramakrishna Engineering College. Sir, we came to know from your lecture how big is small, and all some interesting factors on quantum dots, chemical logic gates, electronic tongue, to name a few. And we really appreciate your way of delivering the interesting lecture, associating the facts with that of nature and few energy applications. I'm sure that most of the participants would have got some research ideas after attending this lecture. Thank you so much, sir, for spending your valuable time and sharing all the research inputs with us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I also would like to extend my acknowledgement to the management and the organizers, SRM Institute of Science and Technology. I would like to extend the thankfulness to our SNRs and Charitable Trust Coimbatore, to our institution and our principal, and our department and our research scholars. I wish all the participants a very good journey during this FDP. If you have anything, you can feel free in writing to me or contacting the organizers. Stay safe during this pandemic. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you. You may sign out, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am.
Participants, the next session will start at 11:10. And before that, I request you all to fill up the feedback form.